As we get older, one of the most common problems we run into is that our joints start to wear down. And one that can often get inflamed is the hip joints. Some people feel stiffness in the morning, others feel pain after a long walk. But to understand why, we need to go inside the hip joint, look at how it's built from inside out. So in this video, we are going to break down the anatomy of the hip joint, its bony structures, the ligaments that stabilize it, how it moves, and some of the most common issues that can damage the hip joint. What's up everyone, my name is Taim, I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. You know, I have this way to really understand something, I need to remove all structures and build it up layer by layer. So that is what I'm going to do here. So after removing all ligaments and capsules, what we can see now is a clean articulation between the head of the femur and the acetabulum of the pelvis. We call this a ball and socket joint. So if you now stand up to add some muscle memory, kick your hip forward, that is called flexion. Backward is hip extension. The hip can also move outwards in abduction, and if you kick back in towards the body, that is called hip adduction. And your hip can also rotate. It can do internal rotation, so hip rotates inwards as a leg kick outwards. The other way is called hip external rotation. So that's how the hip joint moves. Okay, so this is how you never forget the hip joint. First, we move the femur away, and we focus on the acetabulum for a moment. Each one of these landmarks has a function. So the acetabulum has an acetabular margin, acetabular notch, lunate surface, and an acetabular fossae. Now what I'm going to do is add some structures on top of those landmarks. First, we can see the acetabular labrum. This is a fibrocartilaginous rim that is attached to the margin. And what it does is that it improves stability by making the socket deeper. Then there's a transverse acetabular ligament, which bridges across the acetabular notch, stabilizing the joint from beneath. And we can see a central ligament here called the ligament of the head of the femur. It connects from the fovea on the femoral head into the acetabular fossae and help carry a small artery into the joint. Now let's look at this in context. So here is the femur within the acetabulum, and I have faded the hip bone completely to be able to see the structures within. So here we see the acetabular labrum outlining the margin, and here you can see clearly how the ligament of the head of the femur is anchored into the femoral head. And down here, the transverse acetabular ligaments. Now, remember earlier I mentioned the lunate surface? This is where it's located, right here where the head of the femur articulates with this surface. It is covered by articular cartilage, a smooth layer that reduces friction and absorbs shock during movement. And it's only this lunate surface that is in direct contact with the femoral head, not the whole acetabulum. And that begs the question, what about this area in the middle then? Is it not covered by cartilage? This is actually where we find the acetabular fat pad, also called the pulvinar acetabuli. It sits within the acetabular fossae and acts as a space filler, cushioning and supporting the ligament of the head of the femur. Alright, I hope it makes sense so far. Let's keep building on this joint. The joint is directly covered by the synovial membrane of the articular capsule. This layer is a thin, delicate membrane that lies the internal surface of the capsule. And what it does is that it produces synovial fluid, which lubricates the joint to reduce friction and provides nutrients to the cartilage, since the cartilage does not have its own blood supply. Right on top of the synovial membrane, we find the fibrous layer of the articular capsule. This layer is thicker, made of dense, irregular connective tissue, and is continuous with the periosteum of the femur and the acetabulum. This one plays a mechanical role, stabilizing the joint and resisting excessive movements. Now, we're not done. This joint has some extra layers of ligaments that reinforce this capsule. The first one is a pubofemoral ligament, which runs from the pubic part of the acetabulum to the lower part of the neck of the femur. It primarily prevents excessive abduction and extension. The other ligament here is called the iliofemoral ligament. This has a Y shape and it runs from the anterior inferior iliac spine to the intertrochanteric line of the femur. It is often described as one of the strongest ligaments in the body and resists hyperextension when you stand upright. If we now rotate around to the back, we can see the ischiofemoral ligament. This ligament originates from the ischial part of the acetabulum and spirals upward to attach to the femoral neck. It's more posteriorly and support the joint in internal rotation. And that's it. That was the anatomy of the hip joint. Very straightforward once you layer it logically. But the thing about joints, especially the hip, is that they're not invincible. Over time, they get inflamed and irritated. That is when we start using a term you've definitely heard before, arthritis, which literally means inflammation within the joint. There are many causes of arthritis, but I want to show you a few of the common ones that affect the hip joint. Not everything, just enough to give you a good sense of what can actually go wrong in here. So let's circle back for a moment. Remember how I showed you cartilage on the surface of the femoral head and also lining the lunate surface of the acetabulum? The thing is, as you move your hip in all directions, extension, flexion, adduction, abduction, the cartilage that covers the femoral head and the lunate surface starts taking a lot of stress, and over time, it can start wearing out. Now, when cartilage begins to thin, we start to lose that nice, smooth gliding surface. And what that leads to is narrowing of the joint space. The bones come closer together, and that friction between them triggers inflammation inside the joint. And when the body tries to fix this, it sometimes does way more than it should, and you start forming little bony growth at the margin of the joint. These are called osteophytes, or bone spurs. They are basically the body's way to trying to stabilize the joint, but they can actually limit movement further. So instead of a nice, clean arc, the joint margin now becomes uneven and irregular. This process of wear and tear, cartilage breakdown, and bone spur formation is what we call osteoarthritis. So who gets this? The typical person that comes in mind is elderly, right? That's the most common group, adults over 60, just from natural use of the joint over time. But it's not just age. Obesity increases the load of the hip joint, making the cartilage wear down faster. People with heavy physical jobs, like warehouse workers, or people who've had repeated trauma to the joint, like athletes or construction workers, they're also at risk. Even someone who has had a hip dislocation or fracture when they were younger, or congenital problems like hip dysplasia, that can set them up for osteoarthritis later on. Now, what does osteoarthritis actually feel like? It usually starts with slow, gradual pain in the groin or front of the thigh. Patients often say it's a deep ache. Sometimes there is crepticus, a clicking or grinding when they move. The hip feels stiff in the mornings, but it tends to loosen up in under 30 minutes. And over time, it gets harder to rotate the hip internally or abduct it. And walking gets difficult. Climbing upstairs, bending over, even putting on shoes can be a problem. Now, another issue that can affect this joint is something called gout. Gout is actually a metabolic condition. And what happens is that uric acid, which is normally dissolved in blood, starts to build up. And when it reaches a certain concentration, it forms sharp, needle-like crystals that deposit in joints. The immune system sees these crystals and basically freaks out. It sends in neutrophils and triggers this intense inflammatory response called synovitis, meaning inflammation of the synovial membrane. That inflammation causes the joint to swell up, turn red and warm, and become incredibly painful. It's usually sudden, like it flares up at night, and it becomes so sensitive that even touching the skin can hurt. And over time, if untreated, the inflammation starts to erode the cartilage and damage the underlying bone. So who gets gout? It's often people with chronic kidney disease because their kidneys can't get rid of the uric acid properly. It's also linked to hypertension, especially if they're on medications like thiazide diuretics. It tends to hit men between 30 to 50 years old. Obesity makes it worse, and so does high purine diet. Think red meat, seafood, and beer. Even low-dose aspirin can raise the uric acid levels and trigger a flare. In the hip, gout isn't super common, but when it happens, it can be brutal. Sudden pain, intense swelling, the joint feels hot, and movement becomes almost impossible during the attack. Alright, one more condition to mention. Rheumatoid arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is in a different category entirely. This one is autoimmune. Your own immune system targets the synovial membrane and causes it to thicken and swell. This inflamed tissue, called pannus, starts invading and destroying the cartilage and bone underneath. So the joint becomes unstable, deformed, and gradually loses its function. And what's wild is that it is often symmetrical, so both hips might get affected over time. The damage can happen even when the joint is at rest, because it is driven by the immune system, not wear and tear. So who is at risk? Rheumatoid arthritis affects women more than men, especially between ages 40 and 60. There's often a genetic component, HLA-DR4, HLA-DR1, so if someone has family history, they're more likely to get it. Obesity increases the risk, and smoking is a major trigger. Some research even links it to periodontal diseases and certain environmental exposures like silica dust or asbestos. Symptoms-wise, rheumatoid arthritis in the hips show up as deep groin pain or outer thigh pain. It gets worse with inactivity, so people often wake up feeling stiff. The stiffness can last more than 30 minutes, sometimes hours. And as the inflammation eats away at the joint, range of motion decreases and walking becomes difficult. You'll often see weakness in the surrounding muscles, and in later stages, night pain becomes a big issue, especially when lying on the affected side. So that is the hip joint, from its deeper structures, layer by layer, all the way to the most common problems that affect it. I really hope it all made sense and that this video helped. In the next part of the skeletal series, we are going to look at the femur. So if you're ready to keep building your anatomy knowledge from ground up, click the next video and I'll see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.